Breaking tonight, just 24 hours after the final presidential debate, Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump are once again coming face to face, this time in New York City at a charity dinner that is supposed to be lighthearted and fun. But in a campaign that has broken all the rules, it is unclear what exactly is going to happen tonight. Welcome to the Kelly File, everyone. I'm Megyn Kelly. We expect the presidential hopefuls to speak any moment now. This is the warm-up act here. It's Al Smith the Fourth. And when the candidates come out, we're going to bring it to you live. We're going to get to Al Smith IV in a moment, too. Tonight, just to set the scene, it's a little strained in more ways than one. First, Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump just sitting one person apart, with Cardinal Dolan serving as the only buffer. And the Lord is there as well. Second, Mrs. Clinton's campaign has come under fire for leaked remarks about Catholics. Awkward. In fact, Cardinal Dolan himself has called on Mrs. Clinton to distance herself from the comments made by people in her campaign. So far, she hasn't. Mr. Trump has done some things that are not approved by the Catholic Church. He's expected to start any moment now. He'll go first. Let's take a listen to the intros.
So for this evening, all is forgiven. It is now my privilege to introduce the first of this evening's speakers. We determine tonight's order backstage. I'm happy to report, no matter how the coin tossed ended, our next speaker was going to say it was rigged. I'm speaking, of course, about the Republican nominee, Donald J. Trump. There are actually some rumors going around that he wasn't going to show up tonight. He could say he wanted to keep us in suspense. We considered having a Donald Trump cutout on the dais, but if we wanted someone still lifeless, we could ask Charlie Rose to speak again. It is historic that Donald is here tonight. That's right, for the first time, the Catholic Church is not the largest tax-exempt landowner here tonight. We are honored to have Donald and Melania here tonight. The Al Smith dinner is a New York institution. The Donald, a kid from Queens, with a big heart and a big mouth, was without question a New York institution. Donald, the microphone is yours.
And it's working.
Thank you, Al. Wow. That was good. This is a hell of a dinner. Well, I want to thank Your Eminence. This is really great to be with you again. We love it. Governor Cuomo, our great senators. Hi, Chuck. He used to love me when I was a Democrat, you know. Mayor de Blasio. Wherever you are, where is Mayor de Blasio? Huh? Hello, Mayor, come on. See, in the old days, I would have known him very well, but I haven't been doing so much of the real estate anymore. And I want to thank Al and Nan Smith. Just a fantastic job you do with the dinner, and congratulations on a record. Over $6 million, right? This is their record. And a special hello to all of you in this room who have known and loved me for many, many years. It's true. The politicians. They've had me to their homes. They've introduced me to their children. I've become their best friends in many instances. They've asked for my endorsement, and they always wanted my money. And even called me really a dear, dear friend. But then suddenly decided when I ran for president as a Republican that I've always been a no-good, rotten, disgusting scoundrel. And they totally forgot about me. But that's okay. You know, they say when you do this kind of an event, you always start out with a self-deprecating joke. Some people think this would be tough for me, but the truth is, the truth is I'm actually a modest person, very modest. It's true. In fact, many people tell me that modesty is perhaps my best quality. Even better than my temperament. You know, Cardinal Dolan and I have some things in common. For instance, we both run impressive properties on Fifth Avenue. Of course, his is much more impressive than mine. That's because I built mine with my own beautifully formed hands. While his was built with the hands of God, and nobody can compete with God. Is that correct? Nobody, right? That's right. No contest. It's great to be here with 1,000 wonderful people, or as I call it, a small, intimate dinner with some friends, or as Hillary calls it, her largest crowd of the season. this stuff. This is corny stuff. I do recognize that I come into this event with a little bit of an advantage. I know that so many of you in the Archdiocese already have a place in your heart for a guy who started out as a carpenter working for his father. I was a carpenter working for my father. True. Not for a long period of time, but I was for about 3 weeks. What's great about the Al Smith dinner is that even in the rough and tumble world of a really, really hard-fought campaign, in fact, I don't know if you know Hillary, but last night they said that was the most vicious debate in the history of politics, presidential debate, the most vicious. And I don't know, are we supposed to be proud of that or are we supposed to be unhappy? But they did say that, and I'm trying to think back to Lincoln. I don't think they can really compete with that. But the candidates have some lighthearted moments together, which is true. I have no doubt that Hillary is going to laugh quite a bit tonight, sometimes even at an appropriate moment. And even tonight, with all of the heated back and forth between my opponent and me at the debate last night, we have proven that we can actually be civil to each other. In fact, just before taking the dais, Hillary accidentally bumped into me, and she very civilly said, "Pardon me." And I very politely replied, "Let me talk to you about that after I get into office." Just kidding, just kidding. And Hillary was very gracious. She said if somehow she gets elected, she wants me to be, without question, either her ambassador to Iraq or to Afghanistan. It's my choice. But one of the things I noticed tonight and I've known Hillary for a long time, is this is the first time ever, ever, that Hillary is sitting down and speaking to major corporate leaders and not getting paid for it. It's true. It's true. It's true. You know, last night, I called Hillary a nasty woman. But this stuff is all relative. After listening to Hillary rattle on and on and on, I don't think so badly of Rosie O'Donnell anymore. In fact, I'm actually starting to like Rosie a lot. These events give not only the candidates a chance to be with each other in a very social setting, it also allows the candidates the opportunity to meet the other candidates' team. Good team. I know Hillary met my campaign manager, and I got the chance to meet the people who are working so hard to get her elected. There they are. The heads of NBC, CNN, CBS, ABC. There's the New York Times right over there, and the Washington Post. They're working overtime. True. True. Oh, this one's going to get me in trouble. Not with Hillary. You know, the president told me to stop whining. But I really have to say, the media is even more biased this year than ever before. Ever. You want the proof? Michelle Obama gives a speech, and everyone loves it. It's fantastic. They think she's absolutely great. My wife, Melania, gives the exact same speech. And people get on her case. And I don't get it. I don't know why. And it wasn't her fault. Stand up, Melania, come on. She took a lot of abuse. Oh, I'm in trouble when I go home tonight. She didn't know about that one. Am I okay? Is it okay? Cardinal, please speak to her. I'd like to address an important religious matter, the issue of going to confession, or as Hillary calls it, the 4th of July weekend with FBI Director Comey. Now, I'm told Hillary went to confession before tonight's event. But the priest was having a hard time when he asked her about her sins, and she said she couldn't remember 39 times. Nah. Hillary is so corrupt. She got kicked off the Watergate Commission. How corrupt you have to be to get kicked off the Watergate Commission? Pretty corrupt. Hillary is and has been in politics since the 70s. What's her pitch? The economy is busted. The government's corrupt. Washington is failing. Vote for me. I've been working on these problems for 30 years. I can fix it, she says. I wasn't really sure if Hillary was going to be here tonight, because I guess you didn't send her invitation by email. Or maybe you did, and she just found out about it through the wonder of WikiLeaks. We've learned so much from WikiLeaks. For example, Hillary believes that it's vital to deceive the people by having one public policy and a totally different policy in private. That's okay. I don't know who they're angry at, Hillary, you're right. For example, here she is tonight in public pretending not to hate Catholics. Now, if some of you haven't noticed, Hillary isn't laughing as much as the rest of us. That's because she knows the jokes. And all of the jokes were given to her in advance of the dinner by Donna Brazile, which is, everyone knows, of course, Hillary's belief that it takes a village, which only makes sense, after all, in places like Haiti, where she's taken a number of them. Thank you. I don't know, and I don't want this evening without saying something nice about my opponent. Hillary has been in Washington a long time. She knows a lot about how government works. And according to her sworn testimony, Hillary has forgotten more things than most of us will ever, ever know. That I can tell you. We're having some fun here tonight, and that's good. On a personal note, what an amazing honor it is to be with all of you. And I want to congratulate Hillary on getting the nomination, and we're in there fighting. And over the next 19 days, somebody's going to be chosen. We'll see what happens. But I have great memories of coming to this dinner with my father over the years when I was a young man. Great experience for me. This was always a special experience for him and me to be together. One thing we can all agree on is the need to support the great work that comes out of the dinner. Millions of dollars have been raised to support disadvantaged children, and I applaud the many people who have worked to make this wonderful event a critical lifeline for children in need. And that we together broke the all-time record tonight is really something special. More than 6 million net, net, net. The Cardinal told me that's net, net, Donald, remember. We can also agree on the need to stand up to anti-Catholic bias, to defend religious liberty, and to create a culture that celebrates life. America is in many ways divided. Thank you. America is in many ways divided like it's never been before. And the great religious leaders here tonight give us all an example that we can follow. We're living in a time and age that we never thought possible before. The vicious barbarism we'd read about in history books, but never thought we'd see it in our so-called modern-day world. Who would have thought we would be witnessing what we're witnessing today? We've got to be very strong, very, very smart, and we've got to come together, not only as a nation, but as a world community. Thank you very much. God bless you, and God bless America. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
An extraordinary event that we watched right there. The history of the Al Smith dinner is the two candidates trying to turn the page on what is normally an acrimonious season, especially so this time around. And typically, you'll see, we'll get back to them in just one second. Let's turn that sound down so they can listen to one person. But typically it's a sort of self-deprecating presentation, and the humor is at one's own expense. And what we saw there was a little bit of that with some great lines. You got to hand it to Trump, the stuff about Melania, how the media is so biased. Michelle Obama gives a great speech and they love it. And then Melania gives the exact same speech and gets a very different reaction, was funny. But then, wow, you know, there's a saying at another dinner in Washington, singe, don't burn. And there will be questions tonight about whether this one burned, because he went after how corrupt she is. She was kicked off the Watergate Commission. He was booed. She's taken a number of villages, playing off the title of her book, including in Haiti. She's forgotten more than most of us will ever know, and so on, to an unreceptive crowd, and obviously some judgment going on behind Donald Trump as he offered those remarks. It's just an unusual sight for how it normally goes down. It doesn't mean it's right or wrong. It's just not consistent with what we've seen at some others more recently. And then you can see Hillary sort of hobnobbing with Cardinal Dolan, as Trump said, here she is in public pretending not to hate Catholics. We're going to take Hillary when she speaks, but I want to bring in for a quick reaction Katrina Pearson, who's a Trump campaign national spokesperson, and Robert Zimmerman, a Democratic strategist and Clinton supporter.
Good evening.
Let me start with you on it, Robert. These things, it's always fun to make fun of your opponent. That's expected.
Sure.
What did you think of how this went down?
Wow. I'll tell you the truth. This is one of the great national traditions and a great New York tradition, the Al Smith dinner, in honor of the late Governor Al Smith, the first Catholic to, in fact, be nominated for president. But the humor is always self-deprecating, it's lighthearted towards your opponent, and it's always with a great degree of warmth. Regrettably here, I think, yeah, Donald Trump, I don't know if he hired Andrew Dice Clay's writers for his... Okay.
Sorry, Robert.
He missed the mark.
Sorry to interrupt you, but now here comes Hillary. Let's take a listen to what she does in what's been an acrimonious campaign on both sides.
Thank you. Your Eminence, Your Excellencies, members of the clergy, Alan Nance Smith, Donald and Melania, and all the distinguished guests. You know, earlier tonight, Al reminded me that when the first Al Smith ran for president, he chose as his running mate the progressive senator from Arkansas, Joseph T. Robinson, who was one of my husband's political heroes. This work that you do through the dinner, Al, you've done it now for 33 years, is such a labor of love. You've been a hero for both the children of the Archdiocese and for the city of New York. And I think we all owe Al Smith a great, great round of applause. This is such a special event that I took a break from my rigorous nap schedule to be here. And as you've already heard, it's a treat for all of you too, because usually I charge a lot for speeches like this. But for me, it was kind of ironic thinking about a fiery populist, Al Smith. If he were here today and saw how much money we've raised for needy children, he'd be very proud. And if he saw this magnificent room full of plutocrats celebrating his legacy, he'd be very confused. It's a special honor to be here with Your Eminence. Now, I know, Your Eminence, you were criticized for inviting both Donald and me here tonight. And you responded by saying, if I only sat down with those who were saints, I'd be taking all my meals alone. Now, just to be clear, I think the cardinal is saying I'm not eligible for sainthood. But getting through these three debates with Donald has to count as a miracle. So I guess I'm up against the highest, hardest stained glass ceiling. But Your Eminence, you do deserve great credit for bringing together two people who've been at each other's throats, mortal enemies, bitter foes. I've got to ask, how did you get the governor and mayor here together tonight? Now, I've got to say, there are a lot of friendly faces here in this room, people that I've been privileged to know and to work with. I just want to put you all in a basket of adorables. And you look so good in your tuxes, or as I refer to them, formal pantsuits. And, you know, because this is a friendly dinner for such a great cause, Donald, if at any time you don't like what I'm saying, feel free to stand up and shout wrong while I'm talking. You know, come to think of it, it's amazing I'm up here after Donald. I didn't think he'd be okay with a peaceful transition of power. And Donald, after listening to your speech, I will also enjoy listening to Mike Pence deny that you ever gave it. You know, I've had the privilege of being at the Al Smith dinners in years past, and I always enjoy it. But remember, if you're not happy with the way it comes out, it must be rigged. And it's always a special treat for me to be back in New York, a city that I love and which I think truly embodies the best of America. You know, don't you think? People look at the Statue of Liberty and they see a proud symbol of our history as a nation of immigrants, a beacon of hope for people around the world. Donald looks at the Statue of Liberty and sees a four. Maybe a five if she loses the torch and tablet and changes her hair. You know, come to think of it, you know what would be a good number for a woman? 45. But I digress. Now, I'm going to try my best tonight. But I understand I am not known for my sense of humor. That's why it did take a village to write these jokes. People say, and I hear them, I know, they say, I'm boring compared to Donald. But I'm not boring at all. In fact, I'm the life of every party I attend, and I've been to three. And when the parties get out of hand, as occasionally they do, it's important to have a responsible chaperone who can get everyone home safely. And that is why I picked Tim Kaine to be my vice president. Now, you notice there is no teleprompter here tonight, which is probably smart because maybe you saw Donald dismantle his prompter the other day. And I get that. They're hard to keep up with, and I'm sure it's even harder when you're translating from the original Russian. But every year, this dinner brings together a collection of sensible, committed, mainstream Republicans, or as we now like to call them, Hillary supporters. Now, some of my critics, and I hear that too, yeah, they think I only say what people want to hear. Well, tonight that is true. And here's exactly what you want to hear. This election will be over very, very soon. And look at this dais. We got Charlie Rose and Maria Bartiromo and Chris Matthews and Gail King and Nora O'Donnell and Katie Couric. This counts as a press conference, right? It is great also to see Mayor Bloomberg here. It's a shame he's not speaking tonight. I'm curious to hear what a billionaire has to say. And look out at the dais. We've got the Honorable Chuck Schumer, the Honorable Andrew Cuomo, the Honorable Mike Bloomberg, the Honorable Bill de Blasio, the Honorable David Dinkins, and so many other wonderful elected officials. And we have Rudy Giuliani. Now, many don't know this, but Rudy actually got his start as a prosecutor, going after wealthy New Yorkers who avoided paying taxes. But as the saying goes, if you can't beat him, go on Fox News and call him a genius. So as I've said, we've now had our third and thankfully final debate. Sharing a stage with Donald Trump is like, well, nothing really comes to mind. There is nothing like sharing a stage with Donald Trump. Donald wanted me drug tested before last night's debate. And look, I gotta tell you, I am so flattered that Donald thought I used some sort of performance enhancer. Now, actually, I did. It's called preparation. And looking back, I've had to listen to Donald for three full debates, and he says I don't have any stamina. That is 4.5 hours. I have now stood next to Donald Trump longer than any of his campaign managers. Now look, I have deep respect for people like Kellyanne Conway. She's working day and night for Donald, and because she's a contractor, he's probably not even gonna pay her. But I think the good news is that the debates finally allowed Republicans to unite around their candidate. The bad news is it's Mike Pence. And it's been a long, long campaign. That should be one of our highest priorities, shortening the campaigns. And whoever wins this election, the outcome will be historic. We'll either have the first female president or the first president who started a Twitter war with Cher. And if Donald does win, it'll be awkward at the annual President's Day photo when all the former presidents gather at the White House, and not just with Bill. How is Barack going to get past the Muslim ban? Now, Republicans in particular seem frustrated with their nominee. Paul Ryan told the Republican members of the House, you don't have to support the top of the ticket. Don't worry about anyone besides yourself. Just do what's in your own best interests. So I guess Donald really has unified his party around his core philosophy. And I don't understand their unhappiness. They say Donald doesn't have any policies. He has no policies. I keep hearing that. I'd actually like to defend him on this. Donald has issues, serious issues, really, really serious issues. And I worry about Donald's go-it-alone attitude. For example, at his convention when he said, I alone can fix it. You know, in the 90s, I said the same thing about America's health care system, and it didn't work out so well for me either. But speaking of health, Donald has been very concerned about mine. Very concerned. He actually sent a car to bring me here tonight. Actually, it was a hearse. But I kind of want to just put the information out there so everybody can draw their own conclusions and you can judge our relative health. We've each released our medical records. My blood pressure is 100 over 70. His is unbelievably great. My cholesterol is 189. His is presidential. My heart rate is 72 beats per minute. His is the most beats ever, or the least beats ever, whichever sounds best. But Donald really is as healthy as a horse. You know, the one Vladimir Putin rides around on. But I can say without fear of contradiction tonight that I will be the healthiest and youngest woman ever to serve as president. This has really been a strange campaign. You saw it last night. You saw it again tonight. Donald has attacked me for a life in public service, and I didn't get that at first. I kind of get it now. As he told Howard Stern, he doesn't like it when women have been around for more than 35 years. But Donald, we have so much more in common than actually you may realize. For example, I've tried to inspire young people by showing them that with resilience and hard work, anything is possible, and you're doing the same. A third grade teacher told me that one of her students refused to turn in his homework because it was under audit. And here's another similarity. The Republican National Committee isn't spending a dime to help either one of us. So tonight, let's embrace the spirit of the evening. Let's come together, remember what unites us, and just rip on Ted Cruz. I hope you enjoyed my remarks tonight. I said no to some jokes that I thought were over the line. But I suppose you can judge for yourself on WikiLeaks in the next few days. Donald will tell us after the benediction whether he accepts that this dinner is over. He has to wait and see. But there's nothing funny about the stakes in this election. In the end, what makes this dinner important are not the jokes we tell, but the legacy that we carry forward. It is often easy to forget how far this country has come. And there are a lot of people in this room tonight who themselves, or their parents or grandparents, came here as immigrants, made a life for yourselves, took advantage of the American dream and the greatest system that has ever been created in the history of the world to unleash the individual talents, energy, and ambition of everyone willing to work hard. And when I think about what Al Smith went through, it's important to just reflect how groundbreaking it was for him, a Catholic, to be my party's nominee for president. Don't forget, school boards sent home letters with children saying that if Al Smith is elected president, you will not be allowed to have or read a Bible. Voters were told that he would annul Protestant marriages. And I saw a story recently that said people even claimed the Holland Tunnel was a secret passageway to connect Rome and America to help the Pope rule our country. Those appeals to fear and division, can cause us to treat each other as the other. Rhetoric like that makes it harder for us to see each other, to respect each other, to listen to each other, and certainly a lot harder to love our neighbor as ourselves. I believe how we treat others is the highest expression of faith and of service. Now, I'm not Catholic, I'm a Methodist, but one of the things that we share is the belief that in order to achieve salvation, we need both faith and good works. And you certainly don't need to be Catholic to be inspired by the humility and heart of the Holy Father, Pope Francis, or to embrace his message. His message about rejecting a mindset of hostility, his calls to reduce inequality, his warnings about climate change, his appeal that we build bridges, not walls. Now, as you may know, my running mate, Tim, is Catholic and went to Jesuit schools. And one of the things he and I have talked about is this idea from the Jesuits of the Magis, the more, the better. Well, we need to get better at finding ways to disagree on matters of policy while agreeing on questions of decency and civility. How we talk to each other, treat each other, respect each other. So I've taken this concept of Magis to heart in this campaign as best as one can in the daily heat, the back and forth of a presidential campaign, to ask how we can do more for each other and better for each other. because I believe that for each of us, our greatest monument on this earth won't be what we build, but the lives we touch. And that is ultimately what this dinner is all about. And it's why it's been such a great honor to join you all again. Thank you.
And she did it too. I mean, really, that's what we're left with. She went after him just as hard. Somebody just tweeted out, these speeches are a lot more deprecating and a lot less self-deprecating than we normally see. I want to bring back in Katrina Pearson and Robert Zimmerman. Katrina, you tell me. I mean, they're both, I think we were in the burn territory as opposed to the singe. You tell me.
Well, I guess it's my turn to say, wow, she spent her time attacking Donald Trump and not being self-deprecating. Look, we are in the middle of a campaign, a very contentious one, and one where the stakes are extremely high. Mr. Trump definitely was funny. He was his usual charming, funny, entertaining self, but he was also going to make clear, as he pointed out in the room, Megan, that her biggest supporters, NBC, CNN, they were all there. So he was just getting the message out that they refused to.
Robert, were you a little disappointed that she went to the cutting place? She had an opportunity to carve out some high ground there, and she arguably gave it away.
Oh, come on, Megan. If you saw the response from the audience, if you heard her words talking about a sense of unity, overcoming bigotry and fear, and
Donald Trump is healthy as a horse, like the one Vladimir Putin
rides around on. She also threw quite a few shots at herself, too, and to quite a few, but also
so
made
he,
a lot of jokes at her own expense.
The point is, Megan,
the public can decide for themselves just what they think. I think when all is said and done, this is not a Democrat or Republican debate. I think she rose above partisanship. I think she showed really great grace in the tradition of Ronald Reagan or husband President Clinton at the time, certainly Barack Obama. I think she showed great grace in her style.
Stand by. I'm not saying goodbye to you. I'm standing you by because I want to bring in also former Romney campaign strategist Stuart Stevens, who's here, and Trump National Security Advisor and former Michigan Congressman Pete Hoekstra. Thank you all for being here. So, Congressman Hoekstra, let's start with you and your thoughts on whether these two got the tone of this event right.
Well, I have the unfortunate position of only having heard Hillary Clinton's remarks. I did not hear Donald Trump's remarks. I thought, Hillary, I've gone to the gridiron dinner, and you're right. You singe, but you don't burn. She singed, she burned. I've never been to this dinner. So, I really can't relate. The bottom line is, these are not the issues that Americans care about right now. They care about the economy, national security, and those types of things.
But it speaks to what we've seen, Stuart Stevens, in this campaign, which is just this unrelenting ability of these two to just make us feel bad. Right? Am I wrong?
Well, I think politics at our best makes us feel bigger and better, and there hasn't been a lot of that this year. Look, I thought that Obama and Romney were funnier 4 years ago, but in the grand scheme of things, it's a great event. They're there to raise money. I don't think it's going to matter one way or the other.
4 years ago, I think it was four as opposed to eight, but Barack Obama got up there and said, my mother gave me the name Barack. My middle name came from someone who never expected me to run for president. Those kinds of self-deprecating jokes tend to land at these things. But I'll tell you what I saw on Twitter, Katrina, which was some people going off on Donald Trump, saying he's bombing, a ghostwriter's being thrown off of the high floor of Trump Tower right now. Yikes, this is an unmitigated disaster. Then she got up, and what started to pop up was that she was rude, Rudy Giuliani was glaring at her, and that she was borderline vicious in her comments. So where does that leave us?
Well, I think it leaves us at going into the finish line of a presidential campaign, and it's astounding to me how we hear that Hillary Clinton was talking about unity and bringing people together, but then again, Megan, this was one of her public speeches, not one of her private speeches, which we all know now that she has disdain for many Americans, particularly those who don't support her and those who were in the room that were Catholic.
For those who didn't see the beginning of the program, and that's when Donald Trump spoke, we've got a little soundbite to give you a flavor of what happened. Watch.
We've learned so much from WikiLeaks. For example, Hillary believes that it's vital to deceive the people by having one public policy and a totally different policy in private. That's okay. I don't know who they're angry at, Hillary. You're right. For example, here she is tonight in public pretending not to hate Catholics. Now, if some of you haven't noticed, Hillary isn't laughing as much as the rest of us. That's because she knows the jokes. And all of the jokes were given to her in advance of the dinner by Donna Brazil.
Pete Hoekstra, let you tell me whether some of the reaction in that room was the result of a mainstream media that really doesn't like Donald Trump, and they don't want to see him win, and they don't find him funny, period.
Well, they don't find him funny. They've been, over the last year, they've been firmly committed to making sure that Donald Trump will not be president. And what they keep on missing is that Donald Trump has tapped into the frustrations of the American people. They cannot relate to it because they live and operate in a city that has not seen a recession or a downsizing in 30 years.
Congressman,
they live
in
their own bubble.
Have you ever attended that dinner, Congressman? If you didn't, how would you know the audience? How would you know the audience? And the reality is, instead of just resorting to those kinds of partisan and very inappropriate cliches about the Al Smith dinner, which is one of the great traditions of our country and supports so many important, worthy charities that the diocese leads for, I think you ought to be a bit more respectful of the audience and understand, very simply, Donald Trump's jokes just weren't funny.
Go ahead,
they didn't work.
It's time to get off the high horse here. The question that I was asked was by Megyn Kelly saying, do you think part of this is brought on by the media who was in the room, who are primarily, again, from the introduction that I had, was that these are folks that are part of this group of the media that are opposed to Donald Trump. This says nothing about the Al Smith dinner or those types of things.
Those are the people in the room.
Let me stand you by, because I want to ask you, Stuart Stevens, what you thought, whether, because there was a point in during Trump's remarks where people were wondering whether this is now becoming a political matter. I mean, is this sort of oozing over into a place where this could affect people's impressions of these candidates? But what's still ringing in everybody's ears is what happened at last night's debate. And you heard several people make jokes or comments about Trump and the not going to accept the results of the election necessarily. I haven't gotten the chance to get your take on what happened last night.
You know, in my grubby vote-getting perspective, I think debates should be about audiences you're trying to reach that you need voter segments to get to vote for you. The biggest group that Donald Trump needs is women. And I think last night was sort of a disaster for him on that front. The nasty woman comment is just something that we've never heard before in a debate. And there was no targeted effort that he made to really come to grips with what has come out about his past and what has been said and what he said. So, you know, I thought it was actually his worst debate in that regard.
Really? Well, we'll see. We'll see whether the needle gets moved. I mean, Trump did speak to the women issue and offered a lengthy defense of it. It's just a question of whether people found it persuasive. I got to run. It's great to see all of you. Thanks for being here.
Good to be with you.
Also ahead tonight, a big campaign controversy that you heard referenced in that Trump joke that's getting a serious second look after our heated interview with the chairwoman of the Democratic National Committee last night, Donna Brazil. Up next, Sheriff David Clark and Richard Fowler are here on The Fallout. Where did you get it?
You know, as a Christian,